Hey, it's me, Destin. Welcome back to Smarter Every Day. It's time for the Weed Eater episode. And the way you can, why'd I shut the door? The way you can tell that I've staged all this is that this weed eater is gonna crank up immediately. But here's the deal. When it comes to operating a weed eater, I have a mental model in my head of how the weed eater works. Like, as it goes faster, it slings out these lines in a disc, right? But is the disc like a solid line pointing straight out from the weed eater head, or I guess you could call it the trimmer head? Or is it more like a lagging wave? I don't know. Check this out. Let's look. So if I'm gonna weed eat this little spot right here, I rev up the weed eater. But when I don't rev up the weed eater, you can see that the line is lagging. It's all curled up. So at some point in there, it straightens out. And then I can go in and I can trim. And for some reason, I feel like I should trim from right to left. I don't know why, but it just feels like that's something I should do. Let's go over here to this. Watch this. If I come down, should I plunge? See, that lays the grass down in a certain way, but if I go like this, it doesn't. I don't know. My point is, there's a lot of physics in how weed eaters work, and there's these quantitative things that we should be able to measure with a high-speed camera, but there's these qualitative things that you just know if you spend time running a weed eater. So today on Smarter Every Day, I want to take that internal mental model of how weed eaters work that I've developed over years and years of running weed eaters, and I want to test it with a high-speed camera to see if we can understand the physics of how a weed eater works. Let's go get smarter every day. What up?
What's up, man?
Trent is going to be the trigger man on the slow-mo camera for us. So I'm gonna be running the weed eater, and I'm gonna get that weed eater head positioned over this X right here, and we're gonna use this Phantom V2511. We'll record it at about, I'd say 12,000 frames per second, and then we're gonna see if the weed eater line slings out, or more accurately, see how it slings out. Because if you think about it, as the line is whipping through the air, you have aerodynamic drag acting on the weed eater line, but you also have the angular acceleration slinging the line out. So you've got this balance of forces. That being said, the question is, does the line ever truly get straight? Because in my head, I'm operating with a disc with straight lines out of it. 12,000 frames per second. Okay, ready on trigger?
Yep.
Here we go. Ready? It's a simple test, but it should show us exactly how that straightens out.
All right, so as we speed faster and faster, you can see that the line is lagging behind, probably due to that drag that we talked about, but there's also still a little curl at the end of the line, probably because it remembers being wrapped around a spool. My question is, if we make the line even longer, will this drag be even more pronounced, meaning would it lag behind even further? There's only one way to find out. We gotta test it.
If we were to remove this guard, don't do this at home, all that stuff, I think what would happen is we would see that the aerodynamics would start to win, like the drag on the line, right? Here we go. Let's do this. It's hot in this helmet. It's gonna hit my knee. So I'm learning all kinds of stuff, like the torque demand on the motor is a function of the length of the line and the aerodynamic drag. So for example, while he's saving that high speed file, listen to this. It doesn't rev all the way up. Right? But if I cut that line off, I never thought about that. Huh.
This looks so Alabama.
That's a good thing. It's like the Stig. This is the Alabama version of the Stig. Roll Tide, baby.
So once the weed eater line gets to a certain length, the aerodynamic drag is just too much and the whole system lags significantly. But weed eater designers were clever and they integrated a really interesting tool to make sure the line both stays balanced and at the optimum length.
There's a feature in a weed eater where you can tap the head down on the ground. You hit the button at the end and it will release more line from both sides of the spool. There's also an integrated blade in the guard itself, so when the line gets long enough, it'll trim the weed eater line to the right size. But I've always wondered how that cut takes place. This is an older weed eater I've had for a while, and I don't expect it to make a clean cut, but I want to use the slow-mo camera here. And Trent was pretty smart, came up with a mirror to bounce light up in there so we could see it. So let's see what exactly happens when we bump the line and get more. Let's see what that cut looks like.
Good?
Yeah, got it. There's so much to see. So it's not a single cut like I've always thought. It's like a continuous whipping until it pulverizes it into the right length. The torque on the engine is a function of the length of the line. The line is determined by the position of the knife blade. The balance is determined by both sides of the line being equal. It is time to cut grass. Let's go cut grass.
Ready?
Yep.
Okay, I've got a theory that there are different types of grasses that behave differently. Like that was a blade of grass and it kind of delaminated when it started, you know, getting hit by the thing. It started ripping apart. But if we go over here to something like this, that's more of a stalky type of grass. I don't know if you can see this. I wonder what's gonna happen there because it's gonna rip differently. So let's see if we can get a slow-mo of that. Look at this. You've got a stob. That's a grounding rod. So let's replicate that.
We've got a metal stob right here in the ground and it's hammered in. I've noticed that when I'm weed eating and I hit something like that, it'll pull my weed eater in. Okay, here we go.
I always thought that hitting an object like this would pull the weed eater directly towards the steel rod. But if you look closely, you can see that it's a little different than that. The line is hitting the top right side of the steel rod, and you can tell this by the way the line wraps around it and almost makes it look like a pulley. If you were to draw a line in the direction of that force, you can see that that's the direction the trimmer head gets pulled. Just play it forward and you can see that it kind of follows that line. So it's not being pulled directly in like I thought. It seems to be reacting to the force that's being applied to that rod. All this happens so incredibly fast that I never thought about what was actually happening.
Okay, the next thing we're going to talk about is what happens when a weed eater goes up next to a fence. Over here, a long time ago, I had an idea. I wanted to create a little gourd garden, and so I put this wire fencing, if you can see that, I put this wire fencing up next to this wooden fence. Now, over time, for some reason, I came out here and I'd weed eat this thing, and it would break my weed eater line, and I got tired of that. So I just quit weed eating it. So now we have big 20-foot trees and stuff like that. So to try to understand why I got frustrated and quit weed eating that stuff, we have set up a weed eater obstacle course. We've got chain link fence here. We've got what I call hog wire here, which is maybe not quite hog wire, but it's a pretty stout wire, but it's still not quite as strong as the chain link fence. And then we've got this other one. It's a smaller diameter
fencing here. So the idea is, with the stob, the weed eater line would rotate around that stob, right? And it would act like a pulley. If we have a smaller diameter here, does it do that? Or is the minimum bend radius a lot smaller, and will it just cut it?
Okay, it feels more like science if we take some measurements. So, looks like about 110, 112 thousandths of an inch on the chain link. And let's look at the weed eater line itself. Looks like we're around 95 thousandths of an inch.
Yeah, it definitely pulls it to the side. The question is, what is the interaction of that weed eater line to the fencing look like?
Oh, that's awesome. That's awesome.
So it wrapped around it, and at times it doesn't break it, and at other times it does. Oh, what happened there?
Oh. Okay, if the weed eater line wraps 360 degrees around the fencing, then is it a tension break? It rips it.
Okay, cool. So it's like a spaghettification of the weed eater line. It wraps around the fence, and then if it goes 360, it has to unwind the whole thing, and sometimes it's easier just to break. I can't tell if it's a tension break or a shear break. Because the chain link fence is on a diagonal, it looks like as the weed eater line comes in and hits the fence, it funnels it to the corner, and because there's another wire going through the corner, it's like a pinch point. I bet if we go to the smaller diameters, yeah, if we go to the smaller diameter wires, it's gonna have a smaller radius of curvature it has to bend around. Interesting. We need to move on to the next one. What I'm calling hog wire is about 85 thousandths. It definitely grabbed more, and you can see that there was some tension issues there. It's trying to pull. The break is very different than I thought. It's a tension break, at least on this. Because it seems like it's wrapping and it's pulling so fast, it's unwrapping it so fast, like a whip, and it's a tension break. So there you go, we've learned something. If it goes around 360 degrees, then it has a really tough time recovering. Also, this has gotta be different with a square line or a triangular or a polygon type line. We're gonna do another video following up on this with different types of weed eater line. Okay, here we go, time for the small stuff. This is 60 thousandths of an inch. This is smaller than the weed eater line. Let's do it. Whoa. Yeah, that's...
That was scary.
That's scary, but that's what it's like to weed eat. That's why you always like sneak up next to the fence because you're worried that it's gonna grab your weed eater and go?
Okay, it broke at the welds, which makes sense because when you weld wire like that, there's a heat affected zone on that wire. So right there, I would expect right near the weld to be the weakest part of the wire. This didn't break.
Wow. This episode of Smarter Every Day is sponsored by Raycon earbuds. I'm gonna show you my everyday carry stuff. Every morning, I wake up, I get my multi-tool, my phone, my wallet, and I get the Raycons. I throw them all in my pocket, and then I go start my day. But the Raycons are the most interesting thing to me because they have this little case. Sorry, I just got some grass in there. They've got this little bitty case that charges these earbuds, and they pair seamlessly with the phone. It's really impressive. These are called the E25s, the Everyday E25s. And what's so cool about them is you get 6 hours of playtime on these, and they don't cost a lot at all. These things start out at like half the price of the other top premium audio brands, and they sound just as awesome. I like them so much. These are mine, I've had these for months, that I reached out and I purchased these. This is the E55 Performer. Paid for this with my money because I wanted them, and I wanted them in blue. This is what I was super excited about. I just opened these things. I have not tried them yet, but these fit really, really good in the ears. Check this out. It's pretty cool. So I just go right there. Boom. You can run in them. I use them to weed eat, mow the yard, things of that nature. They're fantastic. I haven't tried these E55s yet, but I certainly love the E25s. Now these they sent me because I'm doing this ad, right? Like I didn't pay for these. I did pay for these, because I like these so much. So if you want to check this out, go to buyraycon.com/smarter and you can get 15% off. You will like them, you will enjoy them. Most importantly, if you lose these things, that's not the end of the world. They're priced right in that right sweet spot. You get 4 charges out of the little pill, you get 6 hours on this thing, you're gonna dig them. That's it, buyraycon.com/smarter, 15% off. I hope you enjoyed this video. I've heard people my entire life say, oh, triangular weed eater line is best, square weed eater line is best, twisted square is best, round is best. We're gonna solve that. We're gonna test them like with empirical tests. So we're gonna have data, we're gonna answer the question, what is the best weed eater line? If you would like to see that video, please feel free to subscribe to Smarter Every Day by clicking the little subscribe button, maybe even the bell. If not, that's no big deal. I hope you enjoy your summer out weed eating the yard. I know I am looking forward to it myself. Go get some vitamin D. Anyway, that's it. I'm Destin. You get smarter every day. Thanks for subscribing, maybe, if you feel like this video earned it. If not, that's cool. Have a good one. Bye.